Welcome back. We're discussing World Refugee Day. What are the overarching international problems behind forced migration, and how effective are international organizations in dealing with these issues? Joining me from Oxford, England, is Alexander Betts, Associate Professor in Refugee Studies and Forced Migration at Oxford University. He's also the author of Survival Migration, Failed Governance and the Crisis of Displacement. And here with me in Washington, we have Shelly Pitterman. He is the regional representative of the UNHCR in Washington, D.C. Gentlemen, welcome to the show. Shelly, let me start with you. There's something like 15 million refugees in the world today, people forced to leave their countries. What is the main cause of this mass migration of people?
There are more refugees and displaced persons now than there have been ever since World War II. And regrettably, we have surpassed the 50 million mark, and these are people that are fleeing violence. They're fleeing for their lives, and they're fleeing sometimes across international borders, sometimes within their home countries, but they're fleeing civil conflict, international conflict, they're fleeing sectarian violence, they're fleeing gang violence, they're fleeing localized or generalized violence. Sometimes they're fleeing individualized violence, where they themselves are targeted as individuals.
Right. Alexander, the definition of a refugee is someone who's been displaced but has moved outside his country or her country. Is it time to widen that definition of a refugee? I mean, what about people who are seeking moving to another country for economic reasons, like the thousands of people who are crossing in boats across the Mediterranean to get from Africa to Europe?
The legal definition of a refugee was created at a very particular moment in history for a particular geographical context, post-Second World War Europe. And it focuses on protecting people who are essentially fleeing from persecution by their own governments. Now, of course, today we have a range of so-called new drivers of cross-border displacement. Natural disasters, the environment, fragile states, food insecurity mean many people have to cross borders. And that's blurring the traditional division between forced migration and voluntary economic migration. But it means we need to be very creative in thinking about ways in which people who flee socioeconomic rights deprivations, deprivations of rights that fall outside that framework from the 1950s, to ensure that they too get access to sanctuary and their core human rights.
Right, and Shelly, that poses an interesting legal question. I mean, is the United Nations going to be legally obliged to look after people who are perhaps fleeing because of, as Alexander pointed out, natural causes, food insecurity, and things like that?
The legal obligations for UNHCR are perhaps less clear under such circumstances, but we still have an obligation to help. And so it's in that context that we collaborate with other UN organizations, or we're called upon by the countries that are immediately impacted to use our expertise and our resources to respond. And in many cases, regrettably, we already have a presence because of a pre-existing situation. For example, the floods in Pakistan, we had already been very present on the ground in Pakistan because the Afghan refugees still are the largest refugee population in the world. Syrian refugees are certainly in the news much more, but in any case, having had the presence on the ground, we were engaged very actively with other humanitarian agencies to respond to the flood crisis that hit Pakistan recently.
Right. Alexander, do you find that there is a recognition on the part of developed countries in the world, countries like the United States, Great Britain, perhaps other countries in Europe as well, that they have a responsibility towards refugees? Because in many instances, when we look at some of the violence around the world, it has been caused, for good or bad reason, by developed countries. When you look at the war in Iraq, the war in Afghanistan, and places like that.
I mean, I think historically, there's often a connection between the repressive regimes or the conflicts in the developing world and the role and sometimes complicity of the global north in those activities that lead to the displacement of populations. And I think liberal democratic states like to believe that they support a strong role for protection and the offering of asylum and sanctuary to people in need who flee such situations. But today we see a real reduction in asylum space, in protection space, in the willingness of countries like my own, the United Kingdom, Europe, the United States, and particularly Australia today, to continue to provide asylum and sanctuary. Asylum has been confused often with broader immigration control measures, and there's a lot more restriction at the border. Furthermore, the number of people who are resettled from difficult situations in neighboring host countries next to conflict states or repressive states is relatively low. Less than 1% of the world's refugees ever get resettlement, and those opportunities are only available to the few. In the context of so many people today leaving Syria, it's crucial that the countries with the resources bear a degree of responsibility and share responsibility with neighboring states like Lebanon, Jordan, and Turkey that faced a real crisis today and will probably continue to do so for many years. There's a real commitment today by countries like the US to do that, but the numbers remain relatively small in comparison to the nature of the protection needs and the difficulties faced by host states in the regions in which there are these crises.
Right, and Shelly, I guess in some instances you have refugees who become permanent refugees across perhaps an entire generation. We've got the situation in the Middle East when what used to be known as Greater Palestine was divided into Israel and Palestine. We had the wars that came up, and we now have Palestinian refugees who've been refugees for the last 50 or 60 years.
Regrettably, the level of voluntary repatriation of refugees, in other words, when they're able to go home to a safe space in their home country, that level is the fourth lowest in the last 25 years. Some 400,000 refugees were able to repatriate voluntarily under safe conditions in 2013. So it reflects the fact that Alex referred to, that we have increasing conflict on the one hand. We have stark emergencies that we read about, regrettably, every day in the newspapers and see on television in Syria, in Central African Republic, in South Sudan, now in Iraq. And that's coupled with ongoing protracted refugee situations like the millions who are Afghan refugees, Colombian displaced persons, Somali refugees in Kenya and other places. More recent, some long-standing, you mentioned the Palestine refugee situation as well that dates back. And it reflects a different political, international political situation where there are not solutions. There's more conflict and fewer solutions.
Right. And Alexander, we've seen another very disturbing trend. I don't know whether that's a recent trend, but we find that about half the refugee population in the world today are made up of females, women and girls.
Yes. I mean, I think it's worth recognizing that a huge proportion of refugees are women, but many are also children. And often it's people with particular vulnerabilities that flee across borders. And they find themselves displaced, as Shelley's mentioned, for many years on end. Some two-thirds of the world's total displaced population are in so-called protracted displacement situations. And that means that often people who need opportunities, like young people, including young girls, for education, for advancement, are left in refugee camps in which they have few opportunities, often very little right to work, very little freedom of movement, where there are significant cultural barriers to advancement, particularly for girls and women. And that situation means that unless we break that cycle of protracted displacement, we move beyond encampment and improve opportunities, we face a lost generation of children, including girls.
Right, and how does that complicate your role in this?
Well, first, there's the opportunity. I'd like to bring some good news here, and there is a renewed and very, very energized focus on how working with women, refugees and displaced, can be helpful to finding solutions in terms of locally based community organizations, finding reconciliation, empowering women at the community level to help us to enable refugees to take better care of themselves while they're still refugees or displaced. And so we find collectively as UN and non-governmental organizations a real hope that working with women, addressing the needs of women and children, is a way forward in terms of not just responding to the immediate problems, but also looking for medium-term solutions. But it is a very significant complication for our work. It's a change as well in the focus on individual care and assistance, and not just talking about the millions, but remembering the stories of Naima or individual refugees who need our attention and care.
Right. Alexander, Shelly was telling us that, you know, some of the intentions are great, some of what is being done right now are great, but are you finding that in many countries, especially in Europe, attitudes towards refugees are actually hardening?
I mean, there's a really mixed record. I mean, in the last couple of weeks, I've seen a couple of surveys. One said that people in the United Kingdom who have degrees, university degrees, are generally much more positively predisposed to immigrants and asylum seekers. Another said that generally the majority of the British people are positively predisposed to preserving protection and asylum for refugees. And I think that's reflected in the United States, in Australia, across Europe. The gap, insofar as it exists, is between a real willingness amongst many people, amongst the electorate, to support these populations, and the way often in which refugees, asylum seekers, immigrants in general, are portrayed by the media and political elites. And it's a very difficult position that often politicians find themselves in, to be articulate about the rights of asylum seekers, refugees, and immigrants. But it's an area where really courageous political leadership is urgently needed in order for elected politicians to explain to their electorates and their publics why we have to continue to support refugees, who refugees are, why they're on our territory, and why we need to open our borders to such populations.
But Alexander, we found, as we saw in the recent European elections, that politicians play politics with this. I mean, they go for the popular option.
It's very easy to target refugees, asylum seekers, and migrants for a centre-right or even a far-right party. We've seen in France in the elections with the language of Marine Le Pen, with the emergence of the UK Independence Party in Britain, that the far-right can play the anti-immigrant card. They can highlight the other, and they can stigmatize the people who come from abroad, including refugees, in a way that has a very negative effect on all political parties and on the portrayal of refugees in the media. And that has very real consequences for the ability of people to cross borders. We're raising the boundaries in Europe at the Mediterranean. It's becoming more and more difficult for people to move from sub-Saharan Africa to Europe without needing to use smugglers, without risking their lives crossing the Mediterranean or the Gulf of Aden. So I think we've really got to contest and confront that portrayal by the right.
Right.
And that's why we're very grateful that World Refugee Day is an occasion to also talk about the refugee narrative. There is a difference between the refugee and the asylum seeker, who doesn't have the choice, who is forced to flee their home, and who has a story.
There is a difference, but they end up in the same place, don't they?
They end up in the same place. They have different rights and privileges very often, but they also have fundamentally different needs. They may be moving into a community where they know nobody. They're received in different ways, often by governments. Not to contradict in any way what Alex has said, which I think is essentially accurate, there are also the good examples of Germany, which has just doubled its admission for Syrian refugees coming through the humanitarian admission program. The United States is maintaining a level of 70,000 resettlement, which is, again, as Alex had mentioned, a relatively small number overall, but a great indication of solidarity in the United States for assistance and support to refugees. And those are just a couple of quick examples.
Okay, and that's where we are going to have to leave it. We've run out of time. Alexander Betts in Oxford, Shelly Pitterman here with me in Washington. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us.